So women were allowed to become fellows for the first time in 1916. This is after the Royal Charter has been changed and a bylaw has been added which states words denoting the masculine gender only shall include the feminine gender also. 11 women were elected that year, including Anna Munda, and Isis Bogson was finally elected in 1920. This is 34 years after she was originally elected. Other women elected that year were Alice Grace Cook and Vimita Wilson. Now, they worked for the meteorite section of the BAA, and Cook wrote about how Wilson would work while shrapnel was falling, making things highly dangerous, and zeppelins were dropping bombs in the area. World War II was obviously had a devastating effect on everyone. There were 60 million casualties. About 17 million people were murdered in the Holocaust, including 6 million Jewish people. And of course, some of those events include female scientists, like Margaret Kahn. So Kahn was one of the first women to get a PhD in Germany. She became a doctor of mathematics in 1909. Women weren't allowed to teach at universities at the time. She became a school teacher. When Hitler came to power in 1933, Jewish people were removed from their posts. She was put into forced labor in 1936 and has been considered missing since 1942. Some people managed to escape. I'm going to tell you about one of them now, Marietta Blau. So Blau is known for making the photographic plates. When you see photos like this of CERN, of particles, she was the one that invented these plates, and she explained the physics behind it, how you could devise information from the particle based on the shape of the tracks. So in 1933, Hitler came to power, and almost everyone in Austria, almost every Jewish person, wasn't an Austrian citizen and hadn't fought on the side of Germany during World War I, was removed from their posts. Now, Blau was Jewish, but she was also Austrian, and she chose to stay. She was working with another woman called Hertha Wambacher. Now, she, unbeknownst to Blau, had joined the Nazi Party in 1934. The two women continued to work together for many years. In 1937, they both discovered cosmic rays in these plates. Now, cosmic rays are high energy particles that enter the Earth's atmosphere from space, and we think they come from other stars, so they're actually quite an extraordinary discovery. Blau finally escaped in 1938. Helped her. He'd got her a job teaching physics in a school in Mexico, and she left. Wambacher stayed, carried on the work. She ended up working at the University of Vienna. She was removed from her post in 1945. She worked for 5 years in a research lab until she died in 1950. That year, Schrodinger, who I'm hoping people might know from Schrodinger's cat, he nominated Blau for a Nobel Prize. Unfortunately, she lost out to Cecil Powell, who'd been inspired by her work. It wasn't until 1960 that Blau returned to Austria, where she worked without pay for 4 years, until she was 70 years old. At that point, CERN hired her, and CERN paid her to head a team that analyzes the tracks and particles. So I think she has quite an extraordinary story, and there are a lot of other people like this as well that I haven't really got time to mention today. At the same time, in America, they began to hire women for the first time. So in the 1940s, NASA was known as the NACA. They hadn't really got the space building yet. And they began to hire women. So one of the first women they hired was Mary Golden Ross. Now, she was the first woman engineer to work at Lockheed Martin, and she was the only Native American engineer to work there during the space race. So she was hired in 1942, and she went on to work on engineering systems that went into flyby missions of Mars and Venus, as well as for human spaceflight. So at the same time, NASA also began to hire women to work as computers, just as Harvard had done and Greenwich has done. Now, they hired a lot of black women, and the reason for this, I bet you'll be able to guess, is because they could be paid less to do the same job. So at this point, NASA was segregated. The NACA was segregated, like most places in America, and it remained that way until 1958, when it became NASA. Now, to give you some context, this is 3 years after Rosa Parks refused to give up her bus seat, and 7 years before all black people in America could vote. I find that shocking every time I 1998, under these circumstances of people like Abby Easley. She was a rocket scientist, and she was involved in the launch of a number of space shuttles, military software, weather satellites, all sorts of things. Christine Darden, who was an American mathematician and engineer and expert on sonic booms and supersonic flights. And of course, Mary Jackson, Dorothy Vaughan, and Katherine Johnson, who I think you might know from the Hidden Figures film. Now, all of these women worked on the flight trajectories and windows for Project Mercury, which was America's first human space flight. So this included the flights of Alan Shepard, who was the first American in space in 1961, and John Glenn, who was the first American to orbit the Earth the following year, as well as, of course, for Apollo 11, which put two people on the moon in 1969. Now, the man who devised the training program for the male astronauts in the Mercury project, he was very interested in how women would fare in this project, and he privately funded a project that put female pilots and fighter pilots through the same training. Funnily enough, the women did exceptionally well. 13 women passed, I believe it was about 9 for the men, but I'll have to check that. One of these women was Jerry Falk, and she ranked in the top 2% of all astronauts, regardless of gender. Unfortunately, this was kind of a private project. NASA wasn't taking it that seriously, and it was cancelled before any of the women could go into space. So Cobb left NASA a few years later, and she left to become a humanitarian pioneer, really. She worked for the next 40 years or so as a solo pilot, delivering aid to people in the Amazon, indigenous tribes in the Amazon. So the first woman that did get into space was a Soviet woman, Valentina Tereshkova. Now, she was an amateur skydiver before she trained to become a cosmonaut in 1962. Included weightless flights, fighter jet flights, and over 120 parachute jumps. She ended up orbiting the Earth 48 times over 3 days during her mission, putting in more time and space than all of the male American astronauts that flew before her combined. Unfortunately, the female cosmonaut program was cancelled when people went to the moon. Both countries then turned their attention to space stations where they could conduct long-term experiments on life. So NASA developed Skylab in 1973, but the Soviets at the same time had the Soyuz program, and this ran until 1986 when Mir took over. Mir was then superseded by the International Space Station, and as we know, this is a joint project run between NASA, America, Russia, and lots of other countries. The European Space Agency is involved, and obviously that's a part of us. It was funded until, or it is, sorry, funded until 2024. We obviously hope it will go a lot longer than that. So, the second woman in space and the first woman to enter a space station was Svetlana Slavatska in 1982. So, when she arrived at the space station, her colleague, jokingly, he says, presented her with an apron and told her to get to work. She went to space again 2 years later, where she became the first woman to perform a spacewalk. She welded metal in space for over 3 hours. The third woman in space was American, Sally Ride. Now, Ride finished her PhD at Stanford in 1978. She joined NASA that year, and she devised the robotic arm that's on the space shuttle and became the first woman. Wright was the youngest American astronaut. She still is. She launched at 32 years old. She's also the only openly known LGBT plus astronaut. This wasn't known until after she died, and it was revealed in her obituary that she'd been in a same-sex relationship for over 27 years. Wright went into space the following year on a mission that had two women involved, and the second woman was Katherine Sullivan. She was a geologist and became the first American to perform a spacewalk. She was followed by Annalee Fisher that same year, and NASA made some crazy videos in the 80s. So I've got some videos I'm going to show you now of Katherine Sullivan and Annalee Fisher. And this was filmed just before they went into space, asking them why they want to be astronauts. So I'm just going to play this video.
Never aimed for the space program as such. Arriving on the dumbbells, nothing was worth doing unless you were willing to do what was needed to do the job well. Self-discipline, I think, is tough, but most important factor. And I think it's also important to realize the responsibility that each person has towards all the other people around them. Waxing philosophical, I think we show each other many, many lessons just in day-to-day life. And we can learn a lot from each other. We can give a lot to each other. And that will only be, that will only reach its highest point if each of us individually tries to do the best we can. That's true for our high school exam or a PhD or being an astronaut. You can't just do it for yourself. It does count.
Space program needs my particular academic needs, gives me something that's intellectually challenging, also physically challenging, but much more important, I think, that man needs something to dream about. We've explored our world fairly thoroughly. I realize that the ocean's remaining, that the ship's in that 3/4 of our orbit. There's really just two frontiers left, the ocean and space, and I'd like to be part of that effort.
So the first British person in space was Helen Sharman, a chemist. She was the first woman to go to the Mir space station in 1991. Mae Jemison became the first black woman in space the next year, 1992. She was a medical doctor working for the Peace Corps before she joined NASA. And her colleague here, Sharon McDougal, was her spacesuit technician, and she now manages a team that provides spacesuits for NASA. So, women began to get a few more rights around this time in other fields as well as that. The Royal Astronomical Society presented Vera Rubin with his gold medal in 1996. This is 170 years after the previous woman, Caroline Herschel. So, Rubin was one of the first women in the world to be allowed to use high caliber telescopes. She measured the speed of things in the galaxy, and her results were used to show that the galaxy is probably made up of dark matter. This is, scientists still don't know what dark matter is, so this was incredibly important. The Royal Society gave three more gold medals, two in 2005, one to Margaret Burbidge, who she shared with her husband, one for Carol Jordan, and in 2017 to Michelle Doherty. So Margaret Burbidge used to sneak into Mount Wilson Observatory, and that's how she could use high-caliber telescopes in the 1950s. She used to pretend to be her husband's assistant. Yeah. Because of this, she was able to co-develop the theory of stellar nuclear synthesis. So this shows how elements are made in stars through nuclear fusion. This was really important because people didn't know at the time how stars were fueled. If they were fueled by something like burning, like petrol, then it would only last, the sun would only last for about 7,000 years. So you can see how that's a bit of a concern. So, that was amazing. So, Carol Jordan became the first president of the Royal Astronomical Society in 1994. She was the 19th president overall. She was followed by three male presidents, and then Jocelyn Bell Brunel and Catherine Whaler. Since then, there have been seven male presidents. And again, this is pretty much reflective